today's discussion. I'm here to introduce Peter Eckersall, graduate professor here at CUNY. Thank you so much. Enjoy the panel.
Thank you. Thanks very much. And sorry, I've got a little bit of a cold, so I've got a bit of a husky voice. But if you can't understand me, please let me know, because combined husky voice, Australian accent, it's a bit of a problem in the United States. But first of all, I'd like to thank Frank and Andrew both and all the team at the Siegel Center for organizing this event. I've just been to one of the other panels, and it was sensational. So I'm feeling like it's a bit of a hard act to follow, actually. So anyway, we'll get down to it because we don't have a lot of time. So what I've been asked to talk about today is a topic which is around the concept of the relationship between media and performance. So what happens when you bring new media, principally new media, and by new media we think about things like not just projections, but also the effect of sound and also the effect of design, what I would call the kind of overt emphasis of visuality and audio effects into the theatre. What happens to the theatre dramaturgically when these effects become extremely strong, extremely powerful, and to some extent, I would argue, overwhelming? We move out of a kind of dramatic register, out of a literary register or a dramatic literary register, and into something that is much more akin to the experience of attending perhaps an art installation or some kind of highly affective experience, an experience that impacts very directly on the kind of sensory mechanism of the spectator. So, and we see this quite a lot now. I'm very interested in recent trends in contemporary performance, not just in, you know, the United States, but principally I work on Japan and a little bit on Europe. And I'm seeing a lot of art where at a certain point in a more traditional dramatic structure, the text kind of drops out of the experience of the performance and some other modality of representation or expression takes over, typically a kind of overwhelming visual, audio, or even more recently, this combination of laser and smoke you might have seen in some really interesting performance events. So we did a book on this. It's called New Media Dramaturgies, and a very quick plug to this is a book that's co-authored by myself and Helena Graham and Edward Shear. And the three of us had a project funded through the Australian Research Council to investigate this phenomenon. And part of the outcome of that was the book, and we coined the phrase new media dramaturgy to talk about the kind of the way in which when we think about dramaturgy now, we're not just talking about the kind of dramatic structures of a play or the temporality of a play or the way in which a particular narrative within a play might be situated in relation to character or other narratives or the way it builds and so forth. But we're also talking about the presence of other material properties, the materiality of light, the materiality of sound, the materiality of visuality, and the way that this transforms the experience of performance. The casework I'm actually, case study I'm actually going to talk about today, though, is not a theatre work per se. It's a work that I worked on as a dramaturg with a visual artist named Alexis Dessous. Alexi is a visual artist who works primarily in the medium of photography and film, and he's somebody who works between Belgium and Sydney. He's based in both cities, and through a long circuitous route, I ended up in a conversation with him about a project that he was working on called Phantom Sun, and our discussion began with the fact that he was essentially doing a work that was in some ways a visual document of a particular geopolitical site. And he was visiting the landscape that is right at the top of the world on the border of pretty much Norway and Russia, around the edge of the Barents Sea. And he's been up there in the last 5 years about six or seven times, initially photographing the landscape in the different seasons. And of course, this is a landscape that is Arctic. So in the winter, it's extremely cold and it's extremely dark. And in the summer, it has this brief midnight sun effect where the tundra appears and life frenetically tries to multiply in the kind of 6 weeks that the sun does shine in that period. Geopolitically, this is a site that during the Cold War was extremely important, because essentially you had the kind of border between these two between the East and the West, and this was one of the kind of geopolitical fault lines, because there's a border there between Norway and Russia. It's also a site now that has become much more important for the purpose of the great dream of shipping has been that you can actually go from Europe to Asia via the North Passage, via the Arctic Circle. And for most of my life and most people's life, that was impossible, because essentially the ice never melted enough, and it was you could put a ship through there, but you needed a very big icebreaker. In 2014, four commercial ships, we're talking about oil tankers or other container ships, went through the Northwest Passage, because essentially in the summer now, the ice melts to the point where regular shipping can go through there, or slightly reinforced shipping. In 2014, four ships went through there. In 2016, there were 250 ships going through there. And there's no regulatory framework for this. There's no organization. So there are attempts to set up organizations that will regulate the issues of safety, but also the issues of what happens if there's an oil leak or an accident or in these pristine environments. And it's also an area that is, again, a fault line, because as Russia has become more prominent in a kind of its political nationalism, the relationship between it and, the Scandinavians has become much more complex. And so Alexei was going up there photographing these sites, and they're also very dystopian, because there are many remnants of prior industrial and political, concerns. So there's a lot of mining up there. There was a lot of mining that took place in the Cold War period. There was also reactors. And in one particular instance, there's a site there that is now an abandoned site where the Soviets had a scientific project to drill as deep as they can into the earth. And there's actually a hole there that is now capped, that is drilled further into the earth than, as far as we know, anybody else ever has. So they've gone 2 kilometers down, basically. And this is now like a kind of dystopian science fiction film, an abandoned site where people who live in the area have memory of this activity taking place, and it's now capped off. There's a lot of stories that he collected in relation to all of the various geopolitical, economic and ecological stories that I've been telling. And our conversation began, how do I turn this into a film? And so we had a series of conversations about, well, you could interview these people and make a kind of documentary, but that's not the kind of filmmaker he is. He's primarily a visual artist. And then we started exploring the idea of taking these texts that he'd got from talking to these people and interviewing these people, and we wrote them into a series of little scenarios, and that was my job as the dramaturg. And then we explored the possibility of then employing professional actors to come and play the roles of these people. And in the end, we abandoned that idea, and it ended up as a sort of slightly mysterious set of voiceovers that interweave. It's very dreamlike, this piece that he's made, Phantom Sun, and the voices come in and out. And in that sense, we're trying to capture something that is, on the one hand, extremely tenuous and extremely abstract, and on the other hand, obviously full of these kind of very dystopian, overwhelmingly dystopian and atmospheric tendencies, because the power of the environment here is extraordinary. And in a way, his practice is a practice that is very sensitive to the environment. So his visual work, his visual art is really powerfully enacting these moments. And so I think I'll just show a little bit of Phantom Sun. This is a 20-minute filmic installation that was made in the kind of process I just described. In its showing in a gallery space, it's actually designed and formatted for a very large format projection, part of which happens on the floor. So the viewer sees a two-part image on the wall and on the floor. And we can't repeat that here, but let's have a look at a little bit of, watch about 5 minutes, I think, of Phantom Sun and see, and then we'll take some questions.
What is needed is a new vision for the circumpolar region, an integrated system taking into account resource extraction with maritime and land-based infrastructure. A system that takes into account four key points of reference: resources, reliability, safety, and pollution prevention. These are all extremely important and need to be viewed as a big picture, as an ecology, a new kind. What is needed is independent modeling. We need to visualize the overall system. What is needed is to identify the many stakeholders. A modeling that utilizes computer data, anthropological studies, and climate science. A modeling that includes super tankers, ice water fisheries, and offshore logistical technologies. All of this shows the urgent need for a financial agency to fund this expansion, and thus we see the need for the formation of an Arctic Development Bank. We have to see beyond the existing territories, both on land and sea. We need to recognize these for what they are: inflexible, outdated inheritances from old wars. I would like to remind you all that the Congress of Northern Expansion does not promote or advocate the exploitation of the NSR in this manner. Not for us to consider this.
So just pause. So the text here is actually taken from actual events where we've changed the names, but this is the kind of fantastic imagining that these people are involved in, where they want to essentially invent a new political, economic and industrial system to deal with the exploitation of the North. And at the same time, it's being led by conservationists, because as they say, these people they're like divided subjects. They're activists who've been working for years to protect the environment, but now they're actually trying to control the agenda, but they know they can't hold back the resource extraction and the shipping. So they're just trying to get some actual regulations in place to try and control what is going on with that. Can we just fast forward a bit, because it becomes much more abstract in some of the other bits, and then we'll move out of the tab. There we go. Yep. Just from there, just for another 2 minutes. The Russians are the world experts on icebreaker technology. If you want to send a ship through ice, go to Russia. They know how to do it. The text is a little bit Tarkovsky, of course. It's a little bit, it could be anything else, really. And we'll just move forward a little bit, as I'm aware of the times moving on. Yeah, try there. No, keep going forward. There's one section, one particularly evocative section. Just play it and start from there. And just pause it, please. So, dramaturgically, we oscillated between three key stories. The first one was the story of the Northern Expansion Corporation, who were trying to regulate the environment. The second story was of this son of a man who had worked on the drilling project into the earth, who'd become obsessed. His father had died, but the son had become obsessed with memorabilia of this, and he had a lot of records, and he'd collected them, and he'd actually gone into the site and illegally taken them, and he's now got them in his house, and he's completely obsessed with this idea in a way that borders on a kind of dystopian science fiction imagination. So the memory of this for him is it evokes the greatness of the Soviet Union, that they would embark on this grand plan of drilling through the earth. But it also evokes all these visions of what's down there, what will be released, and all of that kind of thing. The third story, which we didn't get to, is a story that came out of a series of photographs that Alexei took in an abandoned warehouse, where you see the floor, and it's like the floor's got a lot of detritus and rubbish. And then as you can see the detail, you realize that on the floor there's just hundreds of old gas masks with the eye goggles and the little nose now. And then we map into that a story that he was told by the woman who lives in the region, who's producing this as an artwork up there for him, about when she was a child living in the town in a compound of housing. And they would do a drill where at various times the siren would go off at 2 o'clock in the morning or 3 o'clock in the morning. The whole family would get up, they'd put on their gas masks, they'd take the windows, then they'd go out into the hall, and nobody would speak. They weren't allowed to speak. And then all the other families from all the other houses would stand in the hall, and then they'd go down the stairs into the basement, into the nuclear shelter. And it's an absolutely kind of incredibly powerful story. And these images are just remarkable. They're quite striking. And so we oscillated between, if you like, the scientific economic, the dystopian science fiction, and the kind of Cold War memory of a real dystopia, and interwove a lot of other little stories as well. So it's an attempt to present a certain kind of document about the region from very different perspectives and weaving them all together. So I think we're running out of time, so maybe I'll just take a few questions and then we'll wrap up. So.
Hi, as you were talking, the air conditioning came up underneath my legs. And I was just wondering if you considered, or if you've considered playing with the temperature.
Well, that would be very nice, yeah. that's up to Alexei, I guess. That, I mean, it's an interesting question more broadly, because this work is normally shown in a gallery space where they don't have that kind of, where in fact, very often the temperature is regulated in order to protect the artworks. But changing the temperature would be quite an interesting proposition. So, yeah, thank you. Yeah.
From the structure of what I saw, there was a passage from completely no humans, right? Nothing human, just nature, and that into a more constructed built environment. Mm. And I was wondering if there is a point that we didn't see where there are actual humans or no?
No, just voices and text from humans.
Right. Mm. And those the moment when the soldier, mentions the dead soldiers, was that an image of dead soldiers or do you know?
It's a recollection of a man who is preserving the memories of soldiers who died in World War II when there was a battle line there, his recollection is that enemy soldiers were found frozen in embraces to try and stay alive because they're freezing. It's minus 30 or minus 40, so you can't survive without proper survival gear. This particular is a Russian guy who, he's obsessed with collecting the remnants, the memory of this, because the mainstream view has disappeared these kind of little historical events.
Right.
Certainly events where enemy combatants are hugging each other is a powerful image, and one that at least governments would likely repress, unless they do it as a kind of nostalgia, like the. They always talk about the time in World War I where the Germans and the Brits at Christmas played a soccer game. They even made a film of it. But I think that there's very careful prohibitions against humanizing an enemy during a war. So, yeah. Any other questions? Yeah.
I was just curious about the name of that town. What we were seeing right at the beginning, the big panorama of all the shipping equipment and everything. Where was that exactly?
It's in a town called Mamusk and Kursk. Kursk is the main town. There's a big port there which was very active in the Cold War times, because it was actually a military site. A lot of spying going on between the countries there. And then it went into incredible decline, and now it's being reborn because now the shipping is going through that part of the world. Kursk is on the make. So, yes.
I saw on History Channel,
yeah,
where they talked about this, and that, like, right now Russia is trying to claim that area.
Not just Russia, but all the powers that have. If you look at the top of the globe, you've got Scandinavia, you've got Norway and Finland, Russia, Canada, and Alaska in America, all of who have, according to international maritime law, claims over that land, and they're trying to constantly extend those claims, and also under the ice. So they try to claim rights to drill essentially under the water, because there's a lot, they all perceive there's a lot of resources up there. And they're constantly involved in the International Court of Arbitration over these matters and testing the limits of it. But the suggestion is that it also could become a hot war at various times, because people will fight for these wars. The whole question of the border is something that we talk about constantly in this project, because for the local people, they go back and forwards constantly. You know, these are people who are defined by living in a community of extreme isolation and extreme weather. And so for them, it's not important that the border is there. It's important that they have a community of people who share the resources that enable them to survive. And actually, the border is quite open. But the border is there on the map, and it becomes a legal thing. And also, you can't, the idea of a border in that landscape is also, I mean, Alexei's very interested in the kind of way in which the visual experience of the landscape is incredibly imprecise. So if anybody's ever been in a whiteout, for example, in the snow, you know that there's no sense of depth, there's no sense of perspective, there's no sense of, it's impossible to imagine a border in that situation. You're just in a kind of an immense white, where there is no location to space. So that's also a kind of philosophical question or an aesthetic question that we've spoken about a lot. He's really, and we've tried to reflect that in the kind of narrative dramaturgy of the piece, in that these stories never continue to their logical end. They always get interrupted, they always flow into another one. And there's a lot of, you know, memory going on here, which is, may or may not be real. You know, there's a lot of alcohol-affected people here who have been living in them, and who knows by what else. These are irradiated spaces, they're spaces with heavy industries and the presence of lots of toxic waste. So there's a lot of stories of people getting really obsessed by things in the past that probably happened to a degree but may not have happened. The drilling to the earth is it's a classic sci-fi piece.
Great. And on that, thank you very much to Peter for joining the talk. Next door, the Elabash, there's a panel starting. It is a How Did You Make This panel with Jaffa Backus, Jennifer Kidwell, and Scott Shepherd, three really amazing artists, performers, writers, about to start. So if you're interested, please make your way over there. And then you can find us back here at 4:30. We're going to start our selections of work in progress artists. So you can give us a few moments to clear the room and get set up for the next.